And I just wanted to find out if patience Samson Akban is here. She is our moderator this evening. And if not, we'll go ahead and just, I think we can all handle it ourselves if she's not here. I'm Nancy Pontes, and I'll then turn it over to the first speaker that we have. Let me just start this.
Hello everyone, it's a great honor for me to stand here and share our research with you today. And I'm also very grateful for the affirmation and recognition of the Conference Affairs Group. My name is Zhang Mengran from the First Affiliated Hospital of Zhengzhou University. The research I share with you today is the intervention study on blood-borne occupational exposure and the protection of emergency nursing staff in comprehensive third-grade hospital in China. Then I will report from these five parts, which include the research backgrounds, objectives, methods, results, and discussions. First of all, let's look at the concept of blood-borne occupational exposure. Blood-borne occupational exposure refers to the situation that the accidental contamination of sky or mucous membrane by blood and body fluids infected by various pathogens in the process of medical treatment and nursing, or other conditions that could be affected by pathogens, such as pricking scalps, needles, and other sharp instruments, which contaminated with the pathogen's blood and body fluids. Undoubtedly, emergency department as the first line of the hospital position receives all kinds of critical and severe patients in the process of treatment and rescue. In most cases, medical personnel are easily exposed to various infectious microorganisms in the process of treatment and rescue before the patient's information and diagnosis are clear. Therefore, emergency personnel are the high-risk group of occupational exposure. Next, let's focus on the incidence of blood-borne occupational exposure in the world. In this study, a comparative analysis of blood-borne occupational exposure was conducted through the collected literatures. The percentages of blood-borne occupational exposure in all countries vary widely around the world, ranging from 22% in the United States to 63% in Thailand in the past 12 months. Blood-borne occupational exposure is more common in developing countries than in developed countries. At present, occupational protection is getting more and more attention. Countries have established relatively complex standards of occupational protection, monitoring systems, prevention, and treatment processes. We can see these data, however, the current situation of blood-borne occupational exposure of emergency nursing staff in China is still not optimistic. Briefly, our study is based on the investigation of the current situation and the protection of blood-borne occupational exposure for emergency nursing staff in China. This study constructed a protective intervention model of man-machine environment and carried out in non-comprehensive third-grade hospital in China. Finally, through these measures, we explore the impact of measures on the incidence of blood-borne occupational exposure for emergency nursing staff. Through this study, we packed to improve the safety protection knowledge of medical staff, change the attitude of protection, promote the compliance of safety behavior, and reduce the incidence of blood-borne occupational exposure. Then let's explore the method of this study. These are the research object data analysis methods, including and exploring criteria and the research tools. The methods of diversified education. This study adopted the protective intervention model of man-machine environment, which is designed intervention plan from three aspects: diversified education training, optimize the items, and improve the environment. The method of diversified education training include the centralized teaching through PowerPoint, network-centered teaching, nursing forum, specialist training, and academic conference on infection management. For example, nursing forum will share the adverse events of occupational exposure, develop corresponding strategies through brainstorming, and use PDCA management method for continuous quality improvement. Specialist training conducted quarterly occupational exposure training, quarterly assessment to obtain the certificate of infection management specialist training, and participate academic conference related to concurrent occupational exposure at home and abroad. These are the pictures of diversified education training. In addition, specification, operation demonstration, and clinical simulation of blood-borne occupational exposure were carried out in all emergency centers where we conducted our research. The results of preliminary research showed that these operations have high incidence of breaking wood. These are standardized operation processes. In the clinical simulation scene, personnel simulated wrong behaviors, which aims to strengthen the standardized operation process. These are the pictures. Obviously, the most effective way to prevent blood-borne occupational exposure is to eliminate workplace hazards as completely as possible, mainly include the provision of safety appliances, fully equipped hand washing equipment, improving the use of personal protective equipment. Our emergency centers where we conducted our research have equipped safe and closed winners in the warning needle and different types of sharp books. The size of sharp books will affect the occurrence of sharp instrument injury in medical staff, so it's necessary to select different types of sharp books according to the situation. Water hand washing places in the emergency centers where we conducted our research are equipped with effective and convenient non-hand touching forces and dry toilet paper. The quick drying hand disinfectant can be seen in all places touching patients. Similarly, the emergency centers and the transfer wagons of each ward where we conducted our research are equipped with complete disposable isolation suits and gloves. Emergency vehicles are equipped with hand disinfectant and gloves. The improved safety goggles can be used at any time. The improved safety goggles can are used to use and comfortable to wear, which are perfectly equipped in the emergency centers and can be used at any time. Selection of the items in this study referred to the form of safety assessment for medical equipment based on the United States Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, including safety assessment criteria for the use of sharp books, gloves, and safety appliances. In terms of environment, properly planning the layout of this polo room and the rearrangement of the items according to the correct disposal process of medical waste can reduce occupational exposure. And available options including include increasing the number of garbage cans in each ward, properly planning the layout of treatment, shorten the distance between the treatment room and the rescue unit, and make measures to reduce the number of the company personnel. These are five assessment criteria in this study. According to these indicators, we conducted a comparative analysis on the effect of intervention measures. Then this is the data comparison before and after intervention in this study. The results showed that the situation of blood-borne occupational exposure was significantly improved. In a word, blood-borne occupational exposure protection is a hot topic in medical research. After years of practice and attention, although certain results have been achieved, unsafe protective behaviors of emergency personnel are still frequently visible, which needs to be further controlled and solved. We expect this study can provide a reference for the research on prevention and intervention on blood-borne occupational exposure of emergency personnel. At the same time, it can also provide a reference method for reducing the incidence of blood-borne occupational exposure of emergency personnel. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Peng Lei Chui. I'm from Department of Nursing Science, University of Malaya, Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. The topic of my study is on awareness of lifestyle-related cancer risk factor and health promoting behavior among nurses in Malaysia. The essence of nursing is caring. Nurses are known for taking care of others at the cost of their own health. Lack of self-care among nurses can lead to compassion fatigue, personal health problems, and errors on job. The nurses' self-care starts with the awareness of modifiable health risk factor and their behaviors in promoting health. According to the International Agency for Research on Cancer, there is an increase in lifestyle-related cancer due to economic and demographic transitions worldwide. Over 50% of cancer are believed to be attributed to lifestyle factors. The six most established lifestyle-related cancer risk factors were overweight or obesity, insufficient physical activity, the consumption of alcohol, diets high in red meat, diets low in vegetables and fruits, and cured meats. And according to the National Cancer Institute, over 50% of all cancers can be prevented by changing diet and lifestyle. Malik et al. 2011 reported that nurses do not transfer their health promoting role and professional knowledge. And nurses have an increased risk for non-communicable diseases, along with a high prevalence of obesity, poor eating habit, and insufficient physical activity. A number of 50.6% of the Malaysian nurses were either pre-obese or obese. This is from a previous study done by Komarasamy et al. In year 2014. The objective of my study is to assess the awareness of lifestyle-related cancer risk factor and help promoting behaviours among nurses in Malaysia. This is a cross-sectional survey in a tertiary referral hospital in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. A total of 357 participants completed the self-administered questionnaire. The questionnaire consists of three parts. Part one on social demographic characteristics. Part two consists of 29 items measure the awareness of lifestyle-related cancer risk factor of the nurses. Part three includes 52 items with a 4-point Likert skill measure the nurses' health promoting behavior. Of 357 participants, 57% of the nurses are in the age group of 21 to 29. The mean age is 30.9. 61% married, 51% with an average RM ringgit Malaysia, 3,000 and above of this monthly income, 97% with diploma nursing education, 42% have 5 years and below working experience, and 48% of them are working in the inpatient area. 80% shift work and 86% with no health problem. Based on their height and weight, the BMI, the mean BMI of the participants is 25.2. 48% of them are in the normal BMI, 31% overweight, and 60% obese. When asked about which of the following health-related risk factors can make a nurse or a person to develop a cancer, inherited predisposition or the cancer genes is the most popular cancer risk factor, followed by radiation, tobacco, nuclear power, and industrial pollution. With regards to the six established lifestyle-related cancer risk factor, alcohol is reported by the highest number of nurses, followed by cured meats, obesity, diet highs in red meat. As you can see here, 31.7% and 33.6% of the nurses reported insufficient physical activity and diet low in vegetable and fruits respectively. With regards to health promoting behavior, the highest mean score in spiritual growth subskill, followed by interpersonal relationship, nutrition, health responsibility, and stress management. The lowest mean score was from the physical activity subskill. The score is categorized into low, moderate, and high. 37.7% of the nurses reported a low level of health promoting behavior, with 47.4% moderate of health promoting behavior. Almost half of the participants are overweight and obese. The awareness among the six clearly established lifestyle-related cancer risk factor show alcohol garnering the highest number of participants, followed by cured meats, overweight, high red meat diets, low vegetable and fruits diets, and insufficient physical activity. The highest mean score reported in the spiritual growth subskill and the lowest in the physical activity subskill. This finding is consistent with the previous study conducted in the United States and Turkey. 37.7% and also 47.4% of the participants reported low and moderate level of health promoting behavior, respectively. This is congruent with other studies conducted among the nurses worldwide. So, in conclusion, lifestyle-related cancer risk factor, such as overweight, high red meat diet, low vegetable fruits diets, and insufficient physical activity were not prioritized by the nurses. Although almost half of the nurses reported moderate levels of health promoting behavior, it is worth noting that the nurses reported of the physical activity subscale to be the least. The findings have provided a useful insight into the current health behaviors of nurses and may serve well as an important indicator as to where education and supportive services should target their focus. These are my references, and thank you. Any questions, Sue? Thank you.
Hi, good evening. Well, I think it's going to be evening. Late afternoon. My name is Michelle. I'm from Singapore General Hospital. I'm an advanced practice nurse, but I'm representing my team here to present, to share with you our project on motorized trolley for transporting of dialysis and reverse osmosis machine. I would like to thank the organization for giving us, the conference committee for giving us this opportunity to share our project. And before I move on, I would like to also thank my senior management, my chief nurse, Dr. Tracy, and also everyone who has participated in the project and made this possible. This is the outline of my presentation. First, I will go through the background and our team. Don't worry, I will not go through one by one. Just sharing with you who participated in this project and what motivates the team in finally completing this project, what method we use and the outcomes that we have achieved so far, and how are we going to sustain this trolley that we have, and the lesson learned from these projects. Background, in the hospital that I work in SGH, or Singapore General Hospital, we have about 1,800 space, and We perform about 23,000 of dialysis. Out of these 23,000, per year we do about 6,428 off-site hemodialysis service. These include patients in the ICUs and also the isolation wards who are unable to receive the hemodialysis service at the renal dialysis center. So to provide this off-site dialysis service, nurses are required to maneuver a dialysis machine which weighs about 73 to 86 kilograms, as well as a reverse osmosis machine, which weighs about 33 kg. This is just the sample photos of the machines that we have, but we have many others, other models also. These machines are not designed for long-distance maneuver and has posed a challenge in terms of service and maintenance for us due to the wheels, wear and tears, and of course the machine warranty. Only that, we also have nurses need to make 4 trips to transfer the machine to and flow from our dialysis center to the place that they have to provide the dialysis. The distance for each trip varies from 64 meters to 295 meters within the hospital, as you can see from here. For my hospital, we have a few blocks. Due to this 1,800 bed that we have about block 4, block 5, block 6, and block 7, and different levels of wards that we need to go to, whereby the taps are available. So this is our teams. We have a team form involving the hemodialysis nurse, then the engineer, the infection control prevention nurses, the safety officer, and also the environment services experts with the support from the top management, earlier I say, because these machines came with some funding that we managed to get. What is the aim for our project? We hope to design and build a trolley that can transport the two heavy and huge machines at the same time so that our nurses don't have to come back and to and fro. And a lot of our nurses, in order to complete their job, because they are assigned a few patients to complete, they may actually move two machines at one go to bring the machine to the designated wards. So with that, it actually increased their risk of having some spine or back injury. With the use of this trolley, we hope to reduce also the turnaround time between the hemodialysis session so that more dialysis session can be provided for our patients. So what motivates us? We hope that in SGH, all our staff can have a safe and positive working environment. We hope to also improve the staff satisfaction because our turnover can be high due to the nature of the work, and we hope to enhance the care experience so that our patients don't have to wait very long to get their dialysis done. We have multiple meetings, trials and test runs with various stakeholders, including those members that I've told you, and of course we get our machines engineer to review the prototype. It went through multiple changes, and this is through ground feedback, expert opinions, and of course, close observation before we has had the final model confirmed. This is the prototype one that we have, the very first one. Then subsequently, we have a few changes to it, and then finally, this is the one that we have. The final one is the key feature of the final one include less exposure of the trolley motors to spill and splash. The reason is because once the motor has a spill of splashes of water on it, it may actually stop the trolley, and this may cause more inconvenience to the nurse. For ease of access during the maintenance, and then of course cleaning, because we have environmental service with us, they also give us their opinion about how they can help us to maintain the trolley. As there's no braking system in the motor, a lighter trolley has been revised to make it easier for the nurses to control the stop so that when they move the trolley along the corridor to within the hospital, if they meet with beds, patient transporting to the operating theater, they can actually make a stop. I would like to, at this moment, play a short video so that it's easier for all of us to visualize. I hope the video can be played. Just hold on, Oops.
Your left hand is still pressing.
Okay, this is not a very well taken video, but take a close look at my this staff. She's actually 45 to about 48 kg, pushing this trolley. We are trying to trial by moving along the corridor.
This is not the
machine needs to go in to be stopped.
So a lot of us are following her.
Look at the mirror,
around
the corner.
This is the hemodialysis machine, and then we have the RO. We work together with the engineer and also the vendors, the machine vendors, hoping that they can help us and give us their opinion. To ensure, so we are trying to get our nurses. Yeah, so she turned into the our centers,
really,
and then going into the machine room. Alright, so I thought I can show you this video so that it's easier for us to visualize, because I always believe nurses, we need to see the thing, then we'll be able to appreciate it better. So before we talk about the tangible outcome, this is the intangible outcome that we have achieved. We think that this trolley has actually helped us to reduce our accumulated risk level for work-related musculoskeletal disorder, and then we hope it actually has reduced the turnaround time between the hemodialysis session and enable more hemodialysis session sessions to be provided for our patients who may be acutely ill in the ICU or isolation ward. So this is the potential tangible result that we hope to achieve. With this, we can achieve about 0.1 full time FTE per trolley. So how do we sustain this project? This machine currently is undergoing multiple duplications. We have 9 trolley coming on board to my renal dialysis center, and we hope that this can not only help us to improve our workplace safety, but also the staff health. With the positive feedback from the ground, the solution will be rolled out, because we are currently expanding our dialysis provision to our upcoming Department of Emergency Medicine area, and also the upcoming Outram Community Hospital. So this trolley will be able to help us to, because of these two buildings coming up, so the distance will be even longer, and we hope that this trolley can really help our nurses to reduce their effort in pushing it. So the lesson learned from this project is, to me, I feel that, and also together with the team, we felt that it takes actually same goal and passion on safe care, and require the collaboration from all stakeholders, which early on I told you our team member, and we hope this can actually help to improve our staff health. It is important also to manage every individual stakeholder expectation. For example, we do meet with challenges whereby the infection control nurse claim that or they give their expert opinion on certain things cannot be made into the way. And then, of course, the environmental service also told us that when you make it this way, it's difficult for them to maintain. So we try to modify the trolley according to what they want. Nurses in the ground also provide us feedback about how they can maneuver the trolley to park it in the ICU. So with that, we think that to manage everyone's expectation is very important. This will help us to promote a win-win situation. And finally, tapping into individual expertise to formulate a plan will help us to achieve our goals. And I hope that in future, any project that we go on and do more, we will be able to tap on this experience. With that, I thank you. This is the view of all the units that we are in Outram campus. I'm happy to take on any questions. Thank you.
Good afternoon. May I have a question?
Sure.
Yeah. And I see the operation by one nurse. And is it easy to operate these heavy devices or trolley? Because I see that when one nurse taking over the trolley and have a wrist to catch to the wall, is it will operate by 2 person?
No, the trolley is actually a one-man operation trolley. Just the video is because we have not taken a very well-taken video. This was taken because when the trolley was the final prototype came to us, we get the smallest size nurse trying to manipulate it and move it around the building. So that's why you just now see the one is not the best one, of course. But it's a one-man trolley. The hemodialysis machine and the reverse osmosis trolley can be separated. This is due to the limitation of our ICU and also some of the wards. When next to the bed, there's very limited space. So when you reach the ward, you must be able to split them, so in order to put it accordingly to the drainage pipe and the tap. So it's a one-man operated trolley.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sure.
Michelle, that was interesting. Can I just ask, do you keep the HD machine and RO on the trolley itself?
Yes.
You cannot keep it there. That means you will have many sets of it.
Yes, that's why we ordered 9 more, plus okay. the final prototype, we will have 10.
Oh. So does it cost a lot?
One trolley is about SG 10,000.
Wow.
But that is the cheapest I can find because we customize ourselves. The idea, I think in United States, we ever seen in under Fusiness Medical Care, they also have, but we cannot get the local support to support it, so we are unable to purchase from them, and their price is also very high.
So, you said that it under Fusiness Care, and is it any conflict of interest, for example, in the market, there is a gamble or etc., other types of HD machine, so will you open the procurement or to invite their design of the trolley?
I understand your concern. So for, because I also do operation even though I'm an APN, so for us, when we purchased this trolley, we already decided that we will only put on the very new hemodialysis machine. This trolley came timely because at the same time we are purchasing some hemodialysis machine plus reverse osmosis machine, so that the trolley and the machine will expire about the same time, and then you can get it replaced at the same time. The machine cannot be removed, so that's the reason why we gather our vendors, engineer, to be together with us inside this project, so that they can also tell us that how they want our, because with the machine on the trolley, right, it's actually very difficult for them to remove the casing. If you are familiar with how they repair the machine, they will need to remove the casing. So this trolley have to make it in a way that it's easier for them to remove the casing and then do the maintenance and repair. So a lot of work need to be involved if, let's say, you want to customize something to fit your hemodialysis machine and RO.
I'm just wondering, if let's say you go on a road that's very uneven, would that cause any risk to the nursing staff?
In SGH, we don't really have many uneven roads, but of course, if your hospital do have, then we would not really encourage. Then you need to work with the engineer to ensure that the I think they have some engineering that I'm not very familiar with, but they will be able to help you. This trolley actually, because of the how they designed it, right, it actually can reduce more than 50% of the original weight of that tool machine. So that's easy for the nurse to manipulate in case that, you know, you are forced to stop subway, or you came to a small corridor, because SGH is actually a very old building. We have a lot of very small corridor that you need to turn. Yeah. So uneven, we have not tried it because our corridor so far okay. Yeah. Anything? Any more questions? If not, then I will hand over to the next presenter.
Good afternoon. My name is Tatjana Pozarnik. I work as an OR nurse, that means operating room nurse, in University Medical Center, Ljubljana, in Slovenia. And I'm going to talking about, in this presentation, about the hidden danger that we encounter in the operating room. Over 500,000 workers, including surgeons, nurses, anesthesia providers, and surgical technologists, are exposed annually to the hazard found in surgical smoke, according to Occupational Safety and Health Administration. In the Slovenian Operating Room Nurses Association, we want to promote efforts that appreciate support and provide good health and well-being for all employees. We choose the Promoting and Safe Healthy Work Environment project. And for this purpose, we created an informational brochure on the topic of surgical smoke. We presented, in this brochure, we presented the hazards and traps of surgical smoke that we encounter in operating rooms, and also presents the guidelines and recommendations adopted by regulatory agencies and global organizations around the world regarding the most effective system for the surgical smoke evacuation. And what is surgical smoke? Surgical smoke is a gaseous byproduct formed during surgical procedures. It is produced by various surgical instruments, such as electrocautery, lasers, ultrasonic scalpels, high-speed drills, burrs, and saws. Generally, the composition of surgical smoke and aerosols is 95% water vapor and 5% solid particles, such as chemicals, blood and tissue particles, viruses, and bacteria. There are three components of surgical smoke: physical, chemical, and biological. Each type of heat-producing devices produce a different size particles in surgical smoke. The smaller the particle size is, the further it can travel. This can affect non-scrubbed members of the surgical team during a procedure, as well as team members who are scrubbed. Approximately 77% of particulate matter is less than 1.1 microns. The physical component of surgical smoke consists of particulate of 0.3 microns and smaller, and they are called lung-damaging dust. Particles can range in size from 0.0 microns to more than 200 microns. Particles less than 0.3 microns act as a gas, so they can enter the alveoli of the lung. Particles of size 0.25 microns can cross air-blood barrier and enter the bloodstream and lymphatic system. And also, particles can cross a placental barrier. The second component of surgical smoke is are chemicals. There are over 140 chemicals found in surgical smoke, and 40 of them are known to be toxic, mutagenic, and carcinogenic. Perhaps the most poignant of these chemicals is carbon monoxide, along with acrylonitrile. Other chemicals, all out in smaller quantities, include formaldehyde, hydrogen, cyanide, phenol, styrene, methane, and benzene. Significantly, benzene has been shown to be responsible for mutagenicity of electrosurgical smoke. And the third component of surgical smoke is biological portion. Many biological components have been identified in surgical smoke, including intact and viable human papillomavirus, human immunodeficiency virus, and hepatitis B virus. These diseases have been isolated from surgical smoke and grown in the laboratory settings. There are several documented cases of HPV transfer in surgical smoke related to condyloma and cervical dysplastic cases. There have also been cases of cancer cell transfer in surgical smoke. Long-term exposure to these chemicals, even at low levels, can cause serious health problems, such as respiratory irritation with acute and chronic inflammatory changes, hypoxia with dizziness and headache, eye irritation and tearing, sneezing, throat irritation, nausea and vomiting, infectious exposure to HPV, HIV and hepatitis, potential carcinogens, and skin irritation. In many studies, various potential hazards have been identified for surgical patients, including the hazards to which the employees are also exposed and have been discussed before. They are also exposed to the hazards due to the prolongation of the surgery. In laparoscopic procedures, smoke evacuation is critical to the surgeon's visibility. During these procedures, patients are exposed to increased levels of carbon monoxide, carboxyhemoglobin, and metahemoglobin. Later, rapid decompression through a larger troocar valve may result in this release of biological contaminants into atmosphere in the OR. There are several facts about surgical smoke. And we must be familiar if we work in operating room or another procedural areas using energy devices on tissue of any kind. These include, but are not limited to, ablation of 1 gram of tissue produce a surgical smoke with an equivalent mutagenicity to 6 unfiltered cigarettes. 4 to 6 hours in the OR is equivalent to smoking 27 to 30 cigarettes per day. And OR nurses report twice the incidence of respiratory illness than the general population. Currently, the most versatile evacuation options for many operating rooms are the portable smoke evacuation systems. An efficient system for evacuation should have a 4-stage filter system consisting of pre-filter, OLPA filter, carbon filter, and post-filter. OLPA filters are composed of materials which have a performance level of 99.999%, and they capture particles of size 0.12 microns and larger. An efficient evacuation system should have a minimum of airflow at least 60 cubic meters per hour in order to capture the surgical smoke. The recommendation is that the capture device be within 2 inches from the point of surgical smoke production. The smoke evacuation system must be quiet and easy to use. It should be easy to access and portable when it needs to move from one operating room to another. And it should have a sign that informs a healthcare worker when it is time to replace the filter. Filters should be replaced with caution because they contain biological active cells or particular cellular particles. When changing the filter, gloves must be worn because the polluted filter possesses an occupational hazard to healthcare workers and should therefore be disposed as infectious waste. Although the hazards of surgical smoke have been documented for a long time, compliance with the efficiency and standardization of surgical smoke evacuation is still not consistent in all operating rooms where surgical smoke is created. The first step in developing and implementing a program for evacuating surgical smoke is to educate employees that protecting employees and patients against the surgical smoke is a priority. Based on a review on international recommendations and guidelines, the Slovenian operating room nurses recommends that hospital develop guidelines for the elimination of surgical smoke. And in this context, we refer to the AORN guidelines and the recommendations that provide evidence of the hazards of surgical smoke for patients and employees, and discuss methods and parameters for the safe and effective evacuation of surgical smoke during open and laparoscopic surgery. And we also recommend the use of portable smoke evacuation system for the elimination of surgical smoke as the best choice. Thank you for your attention. Any questions?
For someone who studies bullying, I found that really interesting about the surgical smoke. My name's Nancy Pontes, and I'm here to talk about the effects of school bullying, victimization, and gender on weapon carrying among U.S. high school students. I'm going to be comparing some statistical analyses, but I'll try not to bore you with it. There is nothing to disclose and no known conflict of interest. Some of you that follow U.S. news will know that we have a problem with shooting in schools. It's not new. School shootings started close to 300 years ago in the United States, but the phenomenon of targeted mass shootings is relatively new, since 1949. And the town that I live in, or not live in, but work in Camden, New Jersey, is the site of what's considered the first targeted shooting. and that was in 1949. Now, as far as school shootings, we have more school shootings now in the 21st century than all of the years, the previous 300 years already in 2019 and 19 years. So we have had an increase. We know from the studies that access to guns is linked with targeted school violence. This is a very big topic in the United States. And no federal funds are allowed to be used to study weapons that are guns in the United States. So I'm not getting any funding to study this, but I think it's important. The Healthy People 2020 goals are sort of our national objectives and goals for health. And it was considered important enough that they used the Youth Risk Behavior Survey as a data set to source their goal to reduce weapon carrying by students on school property, students that were in 9th to 12th grade. And they had a 5.6% prevalence of students in the past 30 days who carried some kind of weapon to school in the United States. And they wanted to decrease that by 10% by 2020. And the wonderful news is that that has already been happened. People have taken a lot of measures to reduce weapons in schools, and that has decreased. But I consider this a paradox. And the paradox is this. We've done a great job reducing school weapon carrying in schools, but guess what? We have more and more school violence, more targeted shootings in the United States than ever before, despite the fact that our gun control measures have been reducing gun carrying with students in schools. I think it's time, and nurses are good at this, to think upstream. We need to look beyond the gun control measures. They are very important, but we have to look at something like bullying. And bullying victimization at school is seen as a very big risk for people who perpetrate violence by guns in schools. So the perpetrators of targeted school violence have, for the most part, put that as number two risk factor for those who are school shooters. So the purpose of the study was to explore this association between school bullying, victimization, and weapon carrying, try to get underneath the surface and find some variables that impact it. We looked at gun carrying specifically. We looked at gun and other weapon carrying. And then specifically in school, we looked at gun and weapon carrying. We did a comparison of two statistical analyses comparing odds ratios, which is probably what most of you are familiar with, looking at the likelihood between being bullied, how likely are those who are bullied likely to carry a gun or other weapon, and then the risk difference. We investigated the relationship based on gender, males versus females. There's a theory called the strain theory that says that if people are victimized, it generates emotions, negative emotions that result in anger and aggression, and also depression and anxiety. Now, this externalizing of anger and aggression is more commonly thought to be among males. And there's some research to back that up. And among females, it's seen that women tend to internalize more, and that probably shows up in depressive symptoms, and actually suicide attempts are much higher among high school women, even though men are the ones that die by suicide more likely than females. They have more lethal attempts. Our data source was the same used by the government for their Healthy People 2020 goals, and it's a nationally representative sample that's done by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. There's over 80 questions, and it's collected every 2 years. And it's got a very complex sort of sampling, which I won't get into today, but there were 61,042 students who were part of the study that we did. And it was between 2009 and 2015. The secondary analysis estimated measures of both additive interaction and multiplicative interaction. And if any of you are familiar with the strobe guidelines, those are the guidelines that are strengthening the reporting of observational studies in epidemiology. And it's recommending that we don't only use the odds ratio, that we also consider the risk difference or use the risk difference by itself. We used our software and our survey package to do this analysis. In general, the results show that school bullying victimization is significantly associated with weapon carrying. By both measures, odds ratio, risk difference, both showed significance in the association in all these measures. General weapon carrying, gun and other weapon carrying at school, and then gun carrying specifically. So the risk difference, which is what is really recommended by strobe guidelines that we begin using, and in nursing, I think the paper that I did in December was one of the first, I published it in Nursing Research, one of the first that used this on a large scale in nursing research. And we kind of need to get on the bandwagon and think about some of the better ways maybe to analyze data in the future. So I wanted to show you a comparison of the results. Here you can see that with the adjusted risk difference, that males were much more, had much more of a risk, okay? So men who were bullied were much more likely than women to carry a gun or other weapon. And you can see the darker color are the men and the lighter color are the women. So that's actually supposed to be 7.7%. compared to 5.4%. And in terms of numbers, that would be 77 per 1,000 more versus 54 per 1,000 more. So if we look at the old way of doing it, do you see how it's opposite? I'll go back one time. Males more than females, females more than males here. And you might say, why are we having these opposite results? And there's a reason for that. And the reason is because when we look at the baseline for weapon carrying, men in general, males in general, carry weapons more likely than females. And when you do an odds ratio, you're looking at a ratio, not actual number of people. So you can see that here, the odds ratio for females is like they're a little more than two times more likely. But 1.8%, it doesn't take that many more people to double it, right, compared to 6.4. Here we have 11.8%, but it's still a little less than two times more likely. So it has this false appearance that it's more significant. But if you look at the risk difference, in reality it means a clinical difference. 54 more students per 1,000 carried a weapon to school if they were bullied when they were males, compared to 29 students per 1,000 if they were females. So if you're really interested in statistics, you know, feel free to come and talk to me about it. But this is something that I think in nursing we need to really move into this next phase of looking at alternative ways that are recommended for statistics. And we need help. We need other people to help us do some of this analysis because it's very easy to make a mistake. So in conclusion, school bullying increases the risk of weapons that are carried by students in general. And school bullying also increases the risk of gun carrying more in males compared to females. The risk difference also aligns with the strain theory that says that males are more likely to have aggression and anger. And weapon carrying is considered sort of a proxy or a sign of aggression and anger. And the strobe guidelines, again, recommend that we use the risk difference instead of the odds ratio. And I think this is maybe the second study where it actually showed a reversal of the results, which could be confusing if you don't like understand the underlying reason. So just remember that the clinical relevance is important when we look at actually number of people affected. And I think the implications for this in conclusion is really that we need to really up the ante to increase our bullying prevention in schools in the United States and worldwide. It's not just a problem in the United States, but that by doing this, we can really, has been shown that we can reduce victimization, we can reduce gun carrying, we can reduce school violence, and even depression and suicidality. So future research, we need to not ignore the male-female difference. Most of the Centers for Disease Control results only show students all together. And so one of my passions is to show that females and males are represented differently in many cases. And now we can look at people that identify maybe not in your typical male-female gender. So starting in 2017, we can look at people that identify transgendered and other ways. So thank you very much. These are the references. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to take a question. Thank you very much. Let me just see, come on up, yeah. Let me just ask if Dr. Ong is here or Dr. Lee is here. Okay, great. Just wanted to check.
Aloha. My name is Hazel Downing, and I come from Hawaii. I would first like to acknowledge my gratitude to ICN, as well as the Hawaii Pacific University and the Kuakini Medical Center. My presentation covers obesity among nurses, impact on workplace and patient care, and implications for administrators and nursing educators. The problem is obesity among nurses has reached epidemic heights compared to other healthcare professionals. So the purpose of my study was to increase knowledge on current obesity among nurses, to review influence of work factors on obesity, and to examine the relationship between obesity in nurses and the influence on their work performance and patient safety. Hawaii, we have 23.8% of obese adults. Nearly 70% of young adults are overweight or obese in the US. According to a survey, 55% of nurses were obese. Another survey showed 54% of overweight and obese nurses included advanced practice nurses as well as nursing educators. There were other studies done in Scotland and UK where there was a significant increase in the obesity of nurses. In a Korean study, shift work increased the risk of obesity among nurses. A study in Nigeria revealed 27% of healthcare workers were obese. Healthcare workers are at risk occupations leading to obesity. 4% of cancers are related to obesity, and in Hawaii, this rate has doubled. Obesity cancer risk doubles for our millennials. Obesity risk for diseases such as hypertension, stroke, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, and metabolic syndrome is high. The cost of obesity is not only personal, but it also affects the healthcare, it affects the patient and the organizations. So why do we worry about obesity? Well, it is not contagious. But this study has a lot of significance because it creates personal challenges to nurses, unhealthy lifestyles resulting in illness and leaving the profession that impacts shortage. And Florence Nightingale valued nurses caring for their own personal health and being role models for those under their care. I used a systematic review process, and close to 1,200 published articles were reviewed over 12 months and using various databases and keywords. This design was appropriate because it was on the context of obesity, was unique, was timely, and of high relevance. My research questions were, which workplace factors influence obesity among nurses? And what is the relationship between obesity in nurses and the influence on their work performance and patient safety? So I used Maslow's hierarchy. Being physiologically healthy is basic to ensure effective care for others. Obesity causes physiological and safety issues, and this affects motivation and performance. Content analysis was done, and 6 major themes linked to obesity emerged. And these were the 6 themes. Number 1 was occupational injury. Rise in obesity linked to occupational injuries. Rising BMI increased occupational injury claims filed by nurses. The night shift created a disruption of the clock, unhealthy lifestyle choices, and that increased obesity among nurses. Evidence indicates night and rotating shifts result in obesity, and studies showed several diseases are related to shift work. Fewer healthy choices are available at night since the cafeteria is closed. Evidence shows day shift nurses used fitness facilities more than the night shift nurses. Night shift was found to be associated with an elevation in BMI among female Canadian nurses. Canadian men had an association between rotating shift work and overweight and obesity. Increased night shifts per month were significantly associated with increased BMI. Disrupted sleep patterns and inadequate sleep time influence hormones affecting appetite regulation and leading to abnormal eating behaviors. Obesity is also linked to sleep apnea. Sleep apnea causes fatigue, poor concentration, and absent-mindedness. All this affects patient safety. Long hours. Evidence indicates obesity linked to long hours, workplace stress, work balance, as well as lifestyles. Studies show reduction of leisure time, physical activity, and fatigue. All these are connected to obesity. A study among obese nurses indicated when they interact with obese patients, they engage in anti-obesity behaviors or discussions that are harmful to patients. Nurses who do not practice healthy lifestyles may not be motivated to engage in teaching others. Studies indicate being obese made it difficult for nurses to interact with patients in regard to their weight and act as healthy role models and advocates. Patients respond better to healthcare, to health education presented by healthy professionals compared to those who are overweight. However, a normal weight nurse practitioner was questioned by a patient on how could she possibly understand the weight issue. Weight bias. Obese individuals experience disrespect, discrimination, stereotyping such as fat, lazy, undisciplined, and some employers are reluctant to hire them. Patient safety, which is the most crucial of all. Uneven distribution of body weight can affect one's balance, cause musculoskeletal pain, trauma to joints, resulting in risk for injury and patient injury as well. Excessive weight gain has an impact on maintaining body mechanics and posture, increasing the risk for injury to patients. If nurses succumb to health issues from obesity and cannot work, they call in sick more often, and this significantly impacts staffing on the unit. Obese nurses in the ICU mention feeling tired doing CPR and are not able to move fast enough to provide or gather the equipment required during a code. So my conclusions are, workplace has an impact on obesity. Obesity results in major health issues for obese nurses and impacts nurse retention. Obesity impacts work performance and can compromise patient safety. It is sad to know there is only a limited amount of global health organizations who lead in implementing strategic health promotion plans to support healthy weight among nurses. Implications for nurses. Explore more opportunities to rise and drop a size. Become healthy role models. Take personal responsibility and be aware of possible future mandatory policies. administration can reassess occupational influences, recognize weight bias is an issue, provide support for a healthier work environment. Implementation of workplace health program instead of policies directed at weight limits among nurses. Provide a day shift schedule if possible for nurses who are vulnerable to the negative impacts of night shift. Educational leaders can consider redesigning the nursing education program for early weight control among novice nurses. Implications for global health leaders. Should accreditation of healthcare organization include measures to address obesity among nurses? If this data analysis drives decision making on improved health for obese nurses and serves as a platform to design preventive methods, I feel it has a basis for further advancements in the administrative, educational, and humanitarian levels to promote patient safety. I feel there is an urgent need for action to reduce the global incidence of nurse obesity. With that, I'd like to say thank you. Mahalo. Any questions? The next speaker would like to come up. Thank you.
Hello. I am Kei Kyung from I'm a senior staff nurse at the National University Hospital of Singapore. And today I'll be presenting on a study we did, and these are the members of our team. So providing on a live care has a negative impact on the psychological well-being of critical care nurses. And we know that providing end of life care is tough for our nurses. And regular debriefing sessions have been recommended by ICU guidelines. And death rounds is a way for participants to share their experience. So something to note here is that death rounds are not like the typical rounds where nurses may go to visit patients. Instead, it is a place for the participants to gather in a meeting to discuss their experiences. So previous studies have explored the use of death rounds in different populations such as medical residents and multidisciplinary participants. And they found that the participants perceived death rounds to be useful. However, none have explored specifically critical care nurses' perception of attending these death rounds. And death rounds was introduced in 2015 in the medical ICU in NUH Singapore. And this was renamed as care rounds because death rounds sounded pretty grim. This was mainly for nurses, but was open to other ICU healthcare professionals such as respiratory therapists and doctors. Previously, it was facilitated by Dr. Jamie, a palliative care associate consultant. So it started because Dr. Jamie was an attachment to the ICU, and she saw that nurses were distressed and crying when they were providing end-of-life care. And we felt that these care rounds were useful for nurses, and as such, we wanted to conduct this study to describe critical care nurses' perception of attending death rounds. So the rounds are held once a month, and the structure is generally as such. So it begins with 1 minute of silence, followed by a discussion of the nurse's experience and ends off with some words of appreciation. So this was approved by the Domain-Specific Review Board in a 20-bedded medical ICU in NUH, Singapore. Utilizing a qualitative descriptive design with one-to-one audio-recorded semi-structured interviews, we used purposive sampling to gain a wide range of perception. Data saturation was achieved at the 11th participant, and then we conducted 3 more to confirm the data saturation. And data analysis was done using thematic analysis. And peer review was also done for the analysis. So for findings, this is the participant profile of and as you can see in race, religion, and nationality, there's a wide range of different aspects there. As for gender, we only managed to get one male participant. And for number of care rounds, you can see that majority of the participants have attended at least 3 rounds. And so these are the themes and the sub-themes for the study, which I will elaborate more later. This is a schematic diagram of the themes and the sub-themes. You can see that the four central themes are at the center, supported by four pillars. And at the right, there are three barriers which made it difficult for nurses to engage with the care rounds. So for the first theme of the central aims, the nurses felt that care rounds provided them an opportunity to express their thoughts and feelings with providing end-of-life care. And this was a platform for them to remember and reflect on the care that they have provided to the patients. And this helped them to visualize better the patient's journey in the hospital. And so this participant mentioned, "I do see nurses ventilating out their feelings and well during the rounds. It does help them to ventilate and to allay the heavy bottled up emotions." For the second theme of support, the nurses felt that they felt less alone when they were able to verbalize their experiences and receive acknowledgement for their thoughts and feelings. And they felt they could draw peer support from their multidisciplinary healthcare professional colleagues as well. So this participant mentioned, some nurses did share their experience, some were crying, tearing, and the rest were listening and gave support and shared how you would deal with it next time. For the third theme of building cohesiveness, they felt that this was a chance for them to interact with other members of other healthcare professionals, and this helped them to understand, increase their understanding of how other healthcare professionals provide their care, and as such, this increased their bonding and communication with those members. So this participant mentioned, let's say the medical social worker is around, at least once a month they can calm down, we can give them a listening ear so they can listen to us, we can understand them. For the fourth theme of learning to improve care, the nurses felt that this was the care rounds provided them a way to learn about palliative care and to learn from other members, other people participating in the rounds, how they provided palliative care. And this, this knowledge that they gained helped them to improve the palliative care that they deliver on the ground. And so this participant mentioned, because she's a palliative doctor, she's an expert, I will look forward to her sharing her stories. When it comes to her, we try to absorb as much as we can. For the fifth theme of pillars of care rounds, the nurses felt that it was essential for the rounds to be a safe environment for them to verbalize their thoughts and feelings, that the facilitation was done well, that there was some flatness in terms of hierarchy, and that the audience was multidisciplinary. So this participant mentioned, sometimes we wonder why they are still going with active treatment, questions where sometimes in a medical round we don't dare to ask, but when you sit together in a protected environment, they start to ask. And for the final theme of barriers to a successful care round, they found it difficult to engage when the rounds were found to be too formal, that the timing was not good and when they did not know the patients. For timing, there was a mixed perception as to whether it could be better having it before or after work. So this participant mentioned, attending care rounds is sometimes boring because sometimes I don't know the patient. You cannot go with the flow, but if I know the patient, it's okay because I can share my feelings. And once again, these are the six themes and the sub-themes. And for discussion, we feel that care rounds is a viable support system. The nurses in the study perceive care rounds to be useful as a support system, and this was contrary to some studies done previously which found that nurses preferred not to use formal support systems. And the monthly care rounds were perceived not to be timely, but nurses still found it useful. So some participants have suggested some form of post-incident debriefing sessions immediately after the death of a patient, but they still found the monthly rounds to be valuable. And finally, the pillars need to be upheld. This will require resources such as financial and manpower, but this is important because there are indirect benefits such as improving interprofessional communication. And so in conclusion, for clinical practice, we feel that care rounds can help to build interprofessional understanding and critical care nurses' palliative care knowledge. For policy, administrators can examine introducing care rounds and allocating adequate resources for them. And for research, more studies can examine the effectiveness of care rounds as a support system for ICU nurses. How it has helped us? So for our rounds, we found the barriers And we've tried to reduce the barriers that the nurses experience. For example, some have mentioned that they felt bored when they did not know the patient. So we've introduced some mini topics at the end of the session to help them engage with the care rounds. And in this picture, the nurses are were performing back massages for each other as a relaxation therapy. And for future plans, we hope to spread the care rounds to other units in the ICU. And thank you. Any questions? All right, thanks.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Good evening. I am the last speaker. I think you must be hungry, right? Now I will start my topic. I'm Huan Fang Li. I'm from Taiwan. Now I work at the Department of Nursing, National Cheng Kung University. Today, I will share with you my topic. My topic is the predictors of burnout among the nurses in Taiwan. Burnout is far more common among the healthcare workers than among the other professional groups. However, the burnout within the nursing profession is an especially important factor when there is a shortage of nurses. Nurse burnout leads to predicted turnovers that result in manpower shortage and key staffing issues. In Taiwan, with nearly 40% of the nation's nurses are not practicing, 89% of hospitals surveyed reported it was difficult to recruit nurses. Also, our government and the hospital try to make some policies such as improve the staffing improvement and the salary. However, the turnover rate is still high, around 10 to 20%. So it is still need to consent. Burnout is defined as experiencing a state of emotional exhaustion similar to the burnout candle. According to Malaysia, three dimensions of burnout. It was emotional exhaustion, depersonalization, and the low personal accomplishment. Emotional exhaustion occurs when individuals overextend themselves and feel emotionally overloaded. It's the core value of burnout. Second, the depersonalization refers to regarding the patient as an object with the entity, with an attitude of indifference. Low personal accomplishment occurs when individuals think of themselves negatively and consider themselves fails. They also believe themselves to be the inadequate in work-related situation. Individual and the situational factors can result in burnout. Research related to nurse burnout has been conducted in Western countries. However, a lack of understanding remains regarding burnout among the nurses in Asia, especially in Taiwan. Of course, we also investigate individual and the situation factors. For the individual factors are such as the age, marital status, or the length of employment. The situational factors are such as work environment, work satisfaction, or the work engagement. So, the aim of the study was to investigate the predictors of burnout among the nurses in Taiwan. This was a cross-sectional study. We used a proportional stratified random sample of the 483 hospitals in Taiwan. Finally, 35 hospitals participated, including 4 medical centers, 9 regional hospitals, and 22 district hospitals. Of the 1896 nurses were invited to provide the data. Finally, the 1846 completed the questionnaire. We can see the instrument. There are total 5 instruments. First, the Malaysia Burnout Inventory Human Services Survey, the Taiwanese version. It's a 20-item questionnaire. The higher score indicating the subject experienced higher burnout more often. Second is a brief symptom rating scale. It includes the physical and the psychological symptoms. Higher score indicating poor physical and psychological health status. Third is a Mueller and the Mikulski satisfaction scale. It's a 22 items. The higher score indicating more satisfied. Fourth is the work engagement scale with a higher score reflecting a greater engagement. Finally is the nursing work index revised. It's used to measure the work environment. So in the result, a total 98% were female, 74% were unmarried. Mean age was 29 years old. In this table, we can see the characteristic, the variable. Marital status was a significant variable for the 3 subscale. Unmarried nurses, they have higher score than married, indicating they experience a higher level of burnout. In the correlation table, we can find the significant variables such as the work engagement. Here, you can see have a moderate and negative correlation with the burnout total score and the personal accomplishment. The physical and the psychological symptom was also have a moderate corrected to the emotion exhaustion. So in the hierarchical regression model, the significant categorical and continuous variable were included in the linear regression model to predict the total burnout and the subscale. The experience variance were 54%, 35%, 39%, and 19%. We can see work engagement experienced the most variance in the total score, and the personal accomplishment and the depersonalization, and the physical and the psychological symptom can predict more in the emotion exhaustion dimension. So physical and psychological symptoms were the strongest predictor of emotion exhaustion in a nationwide sample. It's maybe because chronic environmental stressor in the workplace may contribute physical and psychological symptoms. A stronger positive correlation was identified between work engagement and the low personal accomplishment. The work engagement was a protective factor to again the burnout. When work engagement is low, maybe there is a little opportunity to present a professional accomplishment. mainly some physical or psychological symptoms to will affect the emotion exhaustion. We can understand sometimes a strong positive correlation maybe between the insomnia or the depression or the anxiety. They are all the physical and the psychological symptoms. So physical or psychological symptom is a strong predictor, emotion exhaustion, work engagement can is a stronger predictor of personal accomplishment and depersonalization. So some strategy needed to provide to decrease the burnout. For example, the resilience training program or the relaxing training program, or the maybe I think the leadership is very important. Sometimes we know the leader may be the stressor to the nurses. So stress is needed to decrease physical and the psychological symptoms and improve work engagement among the nurses in Taiwan to avoid the burnout. So I think this is my team. I also hope we can decrease nurse burnout. We can make it. Thank you. By the way, I have announced next year, 2020, endorsed by ICN, the Taiwan will hold the International Nursing Conference. Welcome to Taiwan. Thank you. Any question? Thank you.
Closing time, open all the doors and let you out into the world. Closing time, turn all of the lights on over every boy and every girl. Closing time, one last call for alcohol, so finish your whiskey or beer. Closing time, you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. I know.